Welcome to QI, where tonight's show is rather rough and ready. At the ready, Tom Allen.
Hello.
Good and ready, Zoe Lyons. Ready for action, Susan Calman. And my little bit of rough, Alan Davis. Their buzzers are rough stuff. Tom goes.
Ooh. What's that?
It's a concrete brick being dragged.
Oh, yeah. Dragged up like with a wig and a dress.
Zoe goes.
Of course.
Yeah. Do that every morning.
Every morning. Susan goes. Oh. Oh, that's an angle grinder.
Is it an angle grinder?
It is. Meeting a goose, I think. It was very unpleasant. And Alan goes.
Ruff, ruff,
Zoe, I hope you don't mind me pointing this out, but you appear to have been in a fight.
You should see the other guy standing.
Yeah. What's happened to your nose? Come on.
I tripped over my own feet, and I suppose at my age that is a fall, isn't
yes.
it?
Yes.
Log the time and date and then the frequency of
the yeah.
fall.
Did a social worker come round to see if you needed any handles anywhere?
Actually, my wife is a nurse, and it was really interesting to see her go to complete and utter pieces. If there's any silver lining to this cloud, the peas that have been in our freezer for the last 15 years got used.
Has anybody ever been in an actual fist fight?
Well.
No.
Why do you think I'm wearing this neck brace? No, but I have been doing boxing lately. And
what?
Yes, Sandy, you wouldn't believe it, but I have. And I'm very good at it. So the man I do it with.
Right. I thought we might start with a little bit of soup to begin. So you've each got a bowl here of beetroot soup. Ooh. So what I want you to do is I want you to demonstrate, please, how to eat this bowl of beetroot soup without getting your ruff all red. Ooh. This did very well. Sorry, I think you've definitely nailed it. I think that is the...
I bought one of those lazy boy sofas.
Yeah.
And I can eat...
anything.
..completely horizontal.
OK, well, they didn't have those sofas in Elizabethan times. What they did have, in fact, was a spoon specifically for eating... You're just going to drink the... Do you like beetroot soup?
It's very nice.
I love all soup.
Yeah, but be careful with beetroot, because in the morning you'll think you need a colonoscopy.
Oh, yes.
It's a terrible thing. See if that's any easier. Thank to... This you. Is a rough spoon. So roughs were...
Actually, very small.
Do you like this? Rather lovely, isn't it?
Mm.
There's more wobble with a longer spoon.
Oh, do you not like the longer spoon?
I find it more difficult.
Yeah.
And what about if you fed each other? Would that be easier?
Oh, yes.
Like
oh, yes.
I don't know if that would be easier.
This is
oh,
like...
I think that's rather beautiful. I think, yes. Yeah, I think that's rather lovely.
Lady in the tramp.
Oh. No! It's gone all down Susan's ruff.
Oh, Susan, I'm sorry.
Tom!
The sight of you slurping that was so disgusting. I kind of dropped the spoon.
So they were ubiquitous in high society. Oh, Susan.
Susan, I'm sorry.
We're talking 1560s to 1620s, but everybody wore them. Women, men, young people, old people.
Dogs.
Dogs still do in a funny sort of way, don't they?
The big cone.
Yeah.
Throw a biscuit in the cone, drives them mad.
Trust me.
They will not rest. They no. will not rest.
No.
I saw a dog walking down the seafront the other day in one of those massive cones, and it was a really, really windy day, but he was walking with the wind at his tail and he was going along quite happy. I thought, yeah, but wait till you turn round, mate.
So the biggest ones were worn by Elizabeth I because, frankly, nobody else had the money to...
How big did she go? Oh, look.
Wow.
They were enormous. So you have to imagine it's up to 7 yards of cloth. So imagine at least between Susan and Zoe, that kind of length of cloth. 600 pleats and soaked in starch. So unbelievably difficult to wear. You did it with something called a goffering iron. And this is what it looked like.
Wabang!
Wow. The end is quite... It's quite familiar looking.
Yeah.
Well, I think once you've done the rough, you think, what shall I do now? But a modern theatrical costume designer takes about 3 hours to set a rough.
It shows how wealthy you are.
Yeah, it does, and that you are indolent.
You're completely safe to be surrounded by starched cloth.
Yeah, and literally looking down your nose at people, aren't you?
Yeah.
This would be the worst part of it because I already struggle.
Yeah.
The other day I took off my bra and there was biscuits in it.
Sorry, biscuit pieces or you were hoarding?
Well, I'd eaten some shortbread.
Right.
And when I took off my bra, it was like bonus biscuits. I ate them.
If I was going to pick a biscuit for you, it would be shortbread.
It's difficult enough for me to eat without... I always slitter on myself as we...
It's called
what? You what?
Slitter on yourself.
Wow.
Slitter on yourself.
Slitter on yourself.
Slitter on yourself. I believe there was a rule against that at boarding. The starching was brought in... It was a Dutch speciality. It was introduced by immigrants into this country.
Sorry, somebody can't keep their spoon in their bowl.
You now got soup all over the table as well.
Would you get just a big straw?
Yeah.
Or a reed, no.
Yes, a reed would work well, wouldn't it?
Oh, soup through a straw.
Well, it'll come to us all, Zoe.
I've had a fall. Did you get these on Tudor Airlines? Under your seat in case of an emergency.
You might have to sit on this if you'd had some sort of operation.
Yes.
Presumably involving that very implement.
Yeah. So there was a Dutch woman called Mistress Dingen van der Plas, and she came to London in 1564. She used to give lessons in how to starch ruffs. She charged £5, which doesn't sound like a lot, but it was £1,500 equivalent today. And then if you did the extra starch-making module, that was another £1, so that was £300. So even just to learn how to do it was fantastically expensive. Now, you've all got white ruffs on, and the paintings often show them as white, but mine is blue, so why might that be? What does it say about me that I'm wearing a blue ruff?
That you're better than us?
No, I'm a prostitute. Or from Scotland.
Oh!
I'm just putting it out there.
Prostitutes wore blue ruffs.
So one of the reasons why we have lots of white in paintings is because of successive restorations. But in fact, there were lots of colours of ruffs. They were principally pink or saffron yellow. Queen Elizabeth I did not like blue because they were associated with what used to be called Winchester geese, which is prostitutes.
Why were they called Winchester geese?
Because the Bishop of Winchester owned so many brothels.
So if I were to come down to London town, I would have been a Scottish whore, basically, because I would have worn a blue ruff. That's quite unfair, I believe.
Well, the big question is, what did prostitutes wear in Scotland?
Yeah.
It must have been very confusing.
Yes.
Are you a prostitute? No, I'm just Scottish.
That's the name of my autobiography.
So the ruff didn't last all that long, and after that came something called the Galilla. It was started by Philip IV of Spain.
That's just a collar.
Well, he just wanted to dial back on the ostentation. The ruff had become such a symbol of upper-class idleness that they thought that we'd better dial it back a bit. And in Britain, we had another successor to the ruff, and that was the Piccadilly. And where do we remember that in London? The Piccadilly? There's a Piccadilly?
Oh, Piccadilly Circus.
Piccadilly Circus, absolutely. There was a place called Piccadilly Hall. It was owned by a man called Robert Baker, and he provided Piccadillys to people.
And what were Scottish prostitutes wearing about this time? Just so I know, Sandy, so I can go back home and just say, you'll never guess what I found out in QI. It's what Scottish prostitutes wore.
And the ruffs, of course, as we said, still worn by dogs. And very strangely, by ministers of the Church of Denmark. I don't know why.
I thought you were going to say Scottish prostitutes. So you go to Glasgow any night of the week, you can tell them a mile away. You really can.
While we're on the subject of prostitutes, who wants to hear about some rough sex?
Me?
Yeah. Okay. Obviously, I'm talking about a bird. I'm talking about the rough sandpaper. Sorry, I said again. Not rough sandpaper.
With some degree of relish.
I did, yeah.
That's one of the sexiest things you've ever said.
Nothing I like more. I find more of a turn-on than carpentry. No. Weirdly true. A rough sandpiper is what I meant to say. This is nature's most gender-fluid bird. So you can see they've got the ruff a bit like the sort of Elizabethan ruff. But this particular bird, there are three types of male and they differ in mating behaviour. So the one that you've got on the left there is called a territorial or an independent male. They've got the dark neck ruff and they make it stand up. The satellite males, they've got the white neck ruff. They will, frankly, go after any woman who will have them. And then we have the feeders. The feeders look identical to females, and they will very quickly have sex with a female who hadn't spotted that they were coming. But they also are quite happy to have homosexual pairings with the independent and territorial ones.
That's fantastic.
Yeah. Right, ruffs off Superway. Let's pop those down there. Right, name an animal that will attack...
Dog.
I think extra point to Alan. I mean, he was fast, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
I didn't realise. What do you think, audience? Fire. Extra point to Alan?
Yeah.
Yeah. Ready? Name an animal...
Horse.
name an animal that will attack anything red.
Bull.
Why do you think that?
Because I've seen clips of those dreadful matadors where they wave the red and then the bull.
Yeah, it's the movement, not the colour, that is.
Really?
Yes, darling, I know. They're not bothered by any particular colour. It just gets irritated by the cloth waving.
It would be a nightmare in a curtain shop, wouldn't it?
Yes.
In fact, I'm surprised that's not a saying, isn't it? Like a bull in a curtain shop.
The one animal which does see red in both senses is the tiny little robin. They are incredibly aggressive. 10% of... huge. They're huge as well. 10% of robin deaths are due to fractured skulls from altercations with other robins.
Oh. I thought it was when they were stapled to Christmas cards. Yeah.
So there was some experiments done by a man called David Lack in 1943, and he showed that a robin would attack a stuffed robin placed in its territory.
Good to know that he was helping with the war effort.
Maybe he was trying to train them up. Secret weapon.
But the robin attacked and the head came off the stuffed robin and the robin carried on. And he began to wonder how little stuffed robin you would need in order to prompt this particular response. So he mounted various body parts on trees and so on. And he found as long as red feathers were present, the robin would attack. A headless, wingless, tailless, legless, bodiless bundle of red feathers was still a legitimate target as far as a robin was concerned. In fact, the robin would sometimes attack a tomato left on the bed.
Except the Nazis were terrified, weren't they?
I know.
So robins can't look in mirrors then, clearly, because it would just set themselves
off. It would set themselves off.
Come on then, come on then, let's have a go.
You'd think the red breast is something to attract.
Yeah.
Before mating, it isn't that at all. It's a warning to stay away. So a robin's breast gets bigger and redder with each year. So the bigger and redder the breast, the more fights it's had. And you don't want to... It's like working with children.
You just said big and red and breasted together and it'll set me off.
Bigger every year.
Bigger every year. Around the pool. Look at that. Big red breast way.
Do you think that robins come back to your garden year after year?
Yes.
They love it.
No.
It's a different one?
Well, they don't last very long, so only 25% of newborns get through the very first year. Less than 1% make it to the age of 5. The lifespan's about 1.1 years for a robin, so they don't actually live.
I thought it was the same robins coming back to my garden, fat robin and thin robin.
Yeah, no, not a thing, I'm afraid. Well, no, probably the robin you know is dead. I should have put that more gently.
And so's the other one.
Yeah. Sorry about that.
Jesus
Happy
Christ.
Christmas.
Jesus Christ. She's really quite harsh there. No, it's dead, Susan.
Dead. I was a terrible parent. No, the gerbil died. Now, on the subject of animals being able to see in colour, how do tigers get away with being orange? That seems an extraordinary colour to me, does it not? Such a bright colour, you would imagine impossible to sneak up on your prey.
I think being a tiger probably puts Elves. Other animals
yeah.
off.
You can choose your own outfit.
Yeah, I mean, they can pretty much have neon lights, high heels and party hats on and still be a tiger.
Well, the answer is that they are able to sneak up on the prey because their favourite meals, which are deer and other ungulates, are orange-green colourblind. So they've only got two colour receptors in their eyes. They are dichromats. Now, we wanted to try and recreate the jungle for you, so...
is it?
So, if you imagine that the tiger is hiding, right? Look, can you see it's hiding? Is it hiding?
So this
there?
Tiger seems very louche.
You can see him because he's orange.
Look at his eyes. He's not out to get anything.
No, right, but when
he's out to complain, maybe in his local pret-a-manger.
See what a deer would see because they cannot see those colours, orange and green. So there's what we might be able to see, yeah. But what they would be able to see is a slightly fuzzier picture. Sort of would blend, I know. And in fact, it wouldn't even be that green, it would be more of a sort of muddy colour so that the thing would hide. So you might think to yourself, have you ever seen pictures of American deer hunters, for example, and they wear those bright fluorescent orange vests? They wear those so that Dick Cheney doesn't shoot them. Yeah. but also because there they are, and you'd think that's surely all the quarry will see them, but of course they can't because they are trying to shoot deer, and deer cannot see orange and green. The friendly garden robin, redbreast by name, headcase by nature. Now pop him down there. Let me just put the rainforest away as well. There we go. Right, what's red and black and a complete racket?
Ooh, Dennis the Menace falling down the stairs.
I love that extra point.
Thank you, Sandy.
So, did you get extra points for being cute?
Yes!
Yeah, good luck with that. Yeah.
Black and white and red all over, I know that one.
What is that?
Newspaper.
Yeah. Yeah.
What goes black, white, black, white, black, white, black, white, black, white?
Is it a nun falling down the stairs?
No, it's a penguin rolling down a hill.
Oh. table tennis rackets.
Oh.
They are, aren't they? Wonder
any shape,
why.
Any size, any weight, but they have to be red on one side and black on the other.
Sorry, any size?
Yes, if you wanted to, you could play with an enormous.
That are you serious?
Yes, so the rule
why
is...
Why wouldn't you?
Because it's difficult. It's you can't spin
no,
it.
No, because the ball's tiny. That's why I'm really
bad
at it.
A tea tray and a broom handle.
Just a mass, any weight and any size.
Yeah, any weight, any size,
you'd
any shape.
You'd have a lightweight one that would be 18 foot in diameter. That's what you'd
just
have.
Just stand at the other end of the table. Just like that. But the red and black thing, anybody know why?
Oh, is it so they can also be used to park an aeroplane?
I'm going to see something now, and it's something that someone said to me once. And you can spin it differently depending on the different sides.
Yes.
What I was told at the youth club.
Is correct.
Oh, Susan.
So they introduced this rule in 1986 because players were using rubbers with different characteristics on the different sides, and the opponent needed to see which one you were using in each shot. What happened was, in 1980, there was a player called John Hilton, and he won the European men's singles title, and it was a shock result. And the reason it was a shock result is that he was only the fourth best player at his local YMCA, let alone in Europe. But he had one of these combination rackets, and nobody could work out which side he was using. And what they needed to do was to see which side you were using because it mattered to the opponent. But what we really want to do with our rackets is a little bit of business. So if you look down beside you, there is a table tennis racket, and we can see that they have one red side and they have one black side. Ooh. Now, what I want you to do is hold your rackets red side up like this, OK?
Smells funny.
Oh, it does.
Oh, yeah.
It could get high as a kite.
Oh, what is that glue?
That's every sports shop you've ever been into condensed into one racket. Is.
That's like Quick Fit, going in the back in Quick Fit. You don't need to know what I was doing in the back. It wasn't quick and it didn't fit. Ooh, yeah, baby.
Right up here.
Have we got any balls?
No, we're not doing that. We're going to toss them in the air and so that the rackets spin over, and I want you to catch it red side up again.
Whoa.
Okay.
Okay. So mine's come up black. Black. Can you...
Oh, sorry.
Mine keeps coming out black.
It's black every time. It's black every time, Sandy. Why is it?
So you cannot do it. Fundamentally, you cannot do it. Oh. If it starts red, it will end up black.
It's so weird.
Look here. We've done a video of somebody rather more adept. And you can see that we flip it and it lands the opposite side each time. Does anybody know why?
Because of the smell.
It's like toast and butter because it's heavier on one side.
No, so you'd think it was something to do with air resistance or gravity or the weight of the thing. There's an American theoretical physicist called Richard Feynman, and he was asked if anybody could explain this in a simple way, and he thought about it for a bit and he went, no. It is called, and I'm going to pronounce it wrong because it's a Russian name, it's called a near enough the Johnny Bakeoff effect. He was a Soviet cosmonaut, and he was up in the Salyut 7 space station in 1985. He spun a wing nut in order to remove it from a threaded bolt. It spun right off the bolt. It continued to spin after it had come loose, and it suddenly flipped over and started spinning in the opposite direction, and then it flipped back to the original orientation and kept flipping from one to another. This had never been seen before. Let's have a look at a video. It is the most bizarre thing. So there it is. Look at it.
Oh, wow.
It's in the air, in the space, simply spinning, and then it starts to spin the other way, and then it spins the other way, and it spins the other way like that.
Is it paired with a wing nut and another galaxy?
This would work with a tennis racket as well. It's to do with it having an axis here and an axis here and an axis here, and this one is the one that we sort of don't think is going to come into play. But it's weird, isn't it?
Yes.
It's weird.
So let's put the tennis rackets away. OK, here are two squirrels. There they are. Which of these is the most recent?
It's the grey, isn't it?
Uh-oh. Oh. Zoe, what were you thinking?
Yeah, I knew that was going to happen. That's why I didn't say anything, Zoe.
July trap, right there. So it is absolutely true that the red squirrel is native to Britain, whereas the grey one is North American. However, the native reds were regarded as an absolute pest and they were hunted pretty much to extinction in the 18th and the 19th century. So in order to restore the population, the reds were imported from Scandinavia, thank you very much, and Central Europe, and we now know from DNA studies that's where most of the reds that we have actually come from. So the reds are, in fact, the modern interlopers and not the native species. The greys, I'm afraid, outlast the reds by quite a long chalk. They're better at problem-solving. The greys also carry a terrible pox virus, which the reds have no immunity to, and the reds get really stressed.
He looks stressed, though, doesn't he?
Yeah, really does look stressed, doesn't he?
Hey, Brian, how you doing? Things aren't going well at work. I've kind of mislaid a couple of nuts. I don't know what's going on. I think my tail is thinning.
The result is that we now have about 2.5 million greys and we have less than 15,000 reds.
Really?
Yeah, I think they're mostly actually in Scotland and in North.
And they are in the islands.
In so big blue rocks.
Yes. Yeah. So there's some in Arran, for example, that you see, but mostly on the islands, because in Glasgow, for example, it's just grey squirrels.
There's a lot of people eat them now.
I was going to say, can you eat them?
There is a restaurant in London, I can't remember which one it is. They do a lot of game and very occasionally they'll have squirrel on the menu. There's nothing to stop you eating a squirrel at all.
This kind of thing of eating locusts and bugs and things like that, about finding alternative sources of protein.
I've tried locusts. That is not pleasant.
I had a locust badgie and it was one of the worst things I've had in my
what's
life.
What's a badgie?
It's like an onion pakora thing, so it's an Indian
dish. What do you mean badgie?
A badgie.
Oh, I...
Sorry!
I honestly thought you said budgie.
I thought you said badgie. I was thinking like a badger, but you wouldn't call a badger a barger, would you?
No.
I ran over a barger the other day.
Because of the unique way that the BBC is funded, you hear all sorts of voices on the BBC, one of which is corrected on her pronunciation of badgie. And then it says, I have a look at badgie.
I just misunderstood.
Was that more understandable
to
your
mistake.
Ears?
It's my mistake, not
I had a locust badgie. I'll do it the whole show like this now. So, he hasn't understood a word I've said. I had a locust badgie the other day.
The thing is, darling, you don't need to do that, because when we put this show out, we'll use subtitles.
You are such bastards!
So this is the Ruff and Reddy show, but what's red and ruffy?
Oh, hello.
Who's allowed that photograph to be taken of themselves?
Mine.
Can I
Can I tell you something in an incomprehensible accent?
Well, why ask now?
Come dancing. The one thing that I had to do, and I wasn't told to do it, but someone said to me, you know, they film it in 4K, and I was like, all right, and you wear a leotard, and I thought, got it. And what they were saying was, please do something, because the first time I got the fitting, I was wearing shorts, and so I had to go for the very first time at the age of 43 for a bikini wax, and it was the most terrifying thing that's ever happened in my entire life. It really was. It was exposing and strange, and afterwards I was so cold.
To be fair, Susan, if somebody suggested you have a wax if you're wearing shorts.
These are going to get shorter, babe, I think. Unless we are transporting triantulas, I think.
Isn't it one of those things that when you've been married for 17 years and you just kind of stop caring because neither of you are going to find anyone else, so you just kind of let it all kind of join up?
Yeah. But it's also knowing what's in vogue if you haven't been on the market for a while, isn't it? Because, you know, I've been with my partner for 20 plus years, and back then it was plaits and beads. Sort of Willie Nelson, if you will.
Okay. Did you go, what's the thing? Bermudan? What's the thing?
Bermudan. A Bermuda triangle when everything disappears.
Just a ship disappeared up there.
Pilots walking out.
Go for it.
World War II pilots.
What year is it? 42.
The things I've seen.
What's it called when you have
Brazilian?
Brazilian. Not Bermudan Triangle. Brazilian.
So the Hollywood's nothing. The Brazilian's the strip. Mm. And then there's something where you just go, just make me a bit like
the Macclesfield. Sod it. Deal with that.
The question was, what's red and ruffy? And it has nothing to do with these pants at all.
It's like a ruffy, like a dog. Is it a red setter?
It is not a no, but we are heading in more of the right direction. We're heading into the in the animal kingdom.
Okay.
Red animal.
Why are we looking at this picture then?
Well, it was meant to spark conversation, and weirdly it did.
I know about a red panda.
OK, no, so it's fish, right? Don't know why. Fish.
Red snapper. Red snapper.
No, it's called the orange ruffy.
Oh. Oh. That's not red, then.
Well, it is actually red. It's weirdly...
These questions are shit. What's red and ruffy? Nothing at all. Yeah.
The smooth orange fish.
The orange ruffy is the answer.
How about if the question had been, tell us about your pubes? Yeah.
15 minutes on your pubic hair. Go.
This fish caught on in American restaurants after 1979 when they changed its name to Orange Ruffy. Do you have any idea why they might have changed its name?
Because all the other fish were also called Dave.
No, its original name was Slimehead.
Well.
Yeah. It's about 30 inches long. It's a member of the perch family.
30 inches?
How big's 30 inches?
No. 2.5 feet.
Yeah. That is a very big fish. And they're extremely long-lived. I mean, assuming that they don't get eaten. The average lifespan is more than 120 years.
No way.
There were two caught recently near Tasmania and one off New Zealand. It turned out to be, we think, about 250 years old, meaning they were born in the late 1700s, so at the same time as the first Europeans arrived in the area as the age of these fish.
How do they age a fish, Sandy? What do you do?
You cut through it and you count the rings.
Yes. You're very nearly right. So fish have something called an otolith. So we all have otoliths. We have one in our ear system, which enables us to basically stay balanced. But in fish, they're layers of calcium carbonate, and they grow over the years. So we can tell how old the fish is by counting the rings in the otolith. It looks a little bit like an onion. It's just a bit like tree rings you can count.
That is amazing.
That's amazing. Well, this is the really sad thing, because if you eat an orange ruffy in a restaurant, there is a likelihood that your lunch is older than your grandparents.
Well, you should eat the older thing first.
Yeah.
And if you've got two pots of hummus, you'll eat the one that's... Yeah. So then you eat the fish and then you eat your grandmother. But do...
Is that every, can you date all, every fish?
All fish can
all
be
fish
aged,
can be aged by, their...
by their otoliths.
That's amazing.
I know, it's so extraordinary, isn't it? It doesn't work the same in humans. Our otolith stops growing after about a week. And then, in fact, it deteriorates as we get older, and it's why old people sometimes have balance problems, is because their otolith is deteriorating.
Zoe, that's why you fell over.
That's it. I'm like an old slime head.
The other fish that kind of goes in and out of fashion is the mullet.
Like the hairstyle.
Oh, yes. Looks so surprised, doesn't it?
What, the mullet?
Yeah, it looks like it's previously gone into something very hard and flat. I'm always worried it's going to happen again.
That's how I look, Zoe. Yeah.
So the mullet in the first century AD in Rome, huge prices were paid for exceptional samples. And the reason that they liked it, the fish changes colour when it dies. So if you bring a mullet to the table alive and watch it suffocate, it is extraordinary.
I'll have that grilled. Yeah.
Actually, I've changed my mind. I'll have the tofu.
But this extraordinary story is Marshall has a story about somebody who sold a slave for 1,200 sesterces and spent the proceeds on a £4 mullet.
Wow, that's... Yeah.
I know. But the mullet haircut actually comes from a Beastie Boys song.
Oh, really?
Mullet Head, the New York hip-hop group.
Say that again, sorry, Sandy.
What?
The New York hip-hop group.
Does hip-hop not sound right out of my mouth?
No, it's fine. I just couldn't understand it because of your accent.
One final red fish, the red-lipped bat fish. This is from Peru. I love this fish. Okay.
Oh. Yeah.
Okay, right. It walks on those pectoral fins rather than swims. And this is the bit that made me so happy. There is honestly nothing on the internet that you can't get. You can get a cuddly toy.
Oh.
But why would somebody make this? Like, people think, oh, I know, the red-lipped bat fish from Peru. Let's make it into a cuddly toy.
Yeah, it looks like it could talk at any minute.
Hello.
Yeah.
Cheap children's television. Hello, children.
It's a very human mouth, actually.
Isn't it?
Yeah. It looks like he's had his lips done.
Mm.
Yeah. Could do with a pair of tweezers, though.
Yeah. Just got to say, oh, give us a tab, will you? I'm gasping for a cab.
Do you want that for one of the children?
Yeah, they'd love that.
Okay.
Do you have children, Alan, or is that just a rant?
How do I know when you are ready for sex?
When I'm finished at the buffet.
Is it you hear the Antiques Roadshow music?
So it's to do with being rattled. Anybody know what being
rattled is?
No, yes. I sheared a sheep recently.
Oh!
Oh, Susan, why?
If you can do that, why can't you sort out your pubes?
Sorry. Extra point for Alan.
I was hand shearing a sheep on Sky.
Yeah. On I'm the sure island of Sky or the television channel?
On the island of Sky.
The television channel.
I got my own series on Sky just shearing sheep. It's on at 2 a.m. Very low viewing figures.
Very soothing, I hear.
And
soothing.
It's something to do with sheep, isn't it?
Yes, it is. It's you, as in E-W-E,
rather.
So it's to do with something called reddle. It's a pigment which is originally made from ochre, so it has a sort of reddish tint. And it's been used for centuries by shepherds to tell whether or not the sheep have... been mated, there's the way to put it.
Right.
So what they would
do
is they would smear this stuff, this ochre, this reddle, onto the chest of a ram and then release him into the flock of ewes to have his fun. And as he worked his way around, you could see, if you look at the... If the lady...
She's got it on her nose. Good. I mean, that's not criticism.
Well, there are three of them. Yeah. I mean, it's not...
More of a thruple.
Yeah.
Going
it?
On here. Nowadays the technique has been refined. There is a range of colours. So you might say put blue reddle on 1 week, and then you might put green in the second week and red in the third. You can tell which you.
She's got blue and yellow.
Yeah.
And red.
Been very busy.
She.
But it helps you work out when the lambing is going to happen. There's even a harness now where they put a sort of crayon or something that they put on the. On the there it is. I know.
Very much reminds me of a trip I once had to Berlin.
Genitals.
Thank you.
Look at the size of them.
That is a.
What am I looking at?
Genitals.
Whoa! Surely that's a pair of baby's feet in socks. What's happened there is a baby has got up the back of the sheep.
Oh, yes. I think
and its feet are hanging out.
I don't know if any of you can remember one of my favourite books, Return of the Native, Thomas Hardy. There's a character in it, Diggory Venn. He's a Reddleman. That's not him, that's Thomas Hardy. So he's a dealer in Reddle and he's got his skin stained all over, and it was a sort of a semi-magical figure, like some sort of devil. And the word raddled, to mean old, comes from the same red dye, so it's you've used too much rouge makeup or you've got a red countenance because you've had a lifetime of overindulgence. The same. It's exactly the same as a shaggy sheep. I don't know what else to say.
Okay, just...
It's a secret. Are we? That's what you brought that boy on for.
Yes, I did. No expense spent. Here is my question. Who has an unhealthy obsession with redundant technology?
A Luddite.
A Luddite of some kind.
Redundant technology.
What kind of technology might that have been if it had not been a man pushing...
Looked like a fax machine.
Fax machine, yes. So who might still be using fax machines?
Security services, because it can't be hacked.
Well, it's certainly true that it cannot be hacked.
Yeah,
so it is
people
using...
want to be off the grid, man.
It's the NHS. They are still the world's largest purchaser of fax machines, although they have been ordered to be phased out in 2020, so it remains to be
Who
seen.
Who are they sending faxes to?
I would imagine each other. Each other,
That's
I would
it.
Imagine. Famously, football transfers used to have to be done by fax.
Yes, and the fax had to get through to headquarters of the FA by the deadline.
Yeah, but they've got some online platform now, presumably.
Text. We've signed him for 80 million.
Yeah.
Ping, ping.
Still huge in Japan, faxes. And pagers were very big in Japan. They closed their final pager service in 2019 and a Tokyo funeral company set up a memorial so people could lay flowers and pay their respects to the end of technology. I know. But with the pager also still going strong in the NHS. Still, yay.
Doctors get paged, don't they?
Yeah, 10% of the world's pagers are in the NHS. 80% of hospitals still use them. Apparently the reason is that reception is very reliable. Other things that have gone redundant, checkbooks, certainly the use of them gone down by about 75% of the last
public
decade.
Telephone boxes.
Even, I say landlines.
Landlines,
right?
Cassette tapes, video recorders, the yellow pages.
What do short people stand on to kiss?
I know! Each other. trouser presses.
Hang on, no, I've used one of those.
And there's one branch of Blockbuster Video still open.
Where?
In Oregon. It's a long way to go.
Wow.
And I would reckon we're probably the last generation to stand at a till. I reckon that will go. You'll just go into the shop, you'll take your things and they'll know somehow.
Yeah.
Magically. I don't like that because I like someone's job to be to count it up and ask me for my money. And then I give them my money and it's all very clear that I have paid for things.
You pay in cash?
Yes, I do. Yeah. I think this is a really important and fundamental issue. Not everybody wants to use technology in their lives. I like to have the interaction of speaking to someone. Sometimes that lady at Morrison's is the only person I speak to in 24 hours. I like to go and I say, how you doing? I'm doing fine. Jammy Dodgers again? Yeah, it's a Thursday. And I like that.
Do you pop them in your bra? Does the lady at Morrison's do that?
Do you want some hand with your
packing? Should I just pop them in there, Susan? Put your tins in there, Tammy Dodgers in your bra.
Now get ready for rough weather. We're heading into a perfect storm of general ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. How can you tell the difference between a raspberry and a blackberry? Yes, Zoe.
Flavour!
Can I just say, we discussed this, a lot of highly intelligent graduates, and not one of us went, it's the flavour straight away. Yeah. We went for something really clever, but...
What
Zoe,
did they come up with? It's flavour, isn't it? They taste different.
It is different.
I don't like the
They are
the
different, look at
them! Yeah, they are different.
Has one got a hole in the middle so you can place it on the end of your finger?
Well, that is the correct answer. So the thing is, you can't do it by looking at them because you can get a black raspberry. That is the thing. So you can't tell by looking at them, but you're right about the hole in them. So when you pick a raspberry, the middle, the stem or the torus pulls out. But when you have a blackberry, it does not. So raspberry.
But it's the flavour!
Yes!
It's the flavour! Surely it's the flavour!
All right, nobody mentioned flavour! I feel so foolish. So here's the thing with raspberries. If a raspberry bush needs to disperse its seeds by encouraging animals to eat them, why does it have prickles? Why would... Surely you want the animals to come and eat and disperse.
Oh, it likes...
It wants a particular sort of animal who isn't put off by a prickle.
Correct.
Wow. You know.
You are nailing the raspberry blackberry.
I was just waiting for the soft fruit section of the show.
So birds and small rodents, they're not bothered by thorns and they can dodge around them. And they are the ones that will take the seeds long distances. And that is what the bush wants. If you get a bear, a large mammal or something, they digest the seeds and then they dump what's left in a single pile of manure and they don't disperse the seeds. So
or they make them into jam and sell them.
Done, Zoe. That was absolutely... You scored highly on that particular soft fruit section.
I like a berry.
What about a currant?
Not fond of currants. I've tried them.
OK, moving on. Honestly, it's like being in an old people's home. A blackberry with no middle is simply a funny-coloured raspberry. When it comes to sauce, I know what I like and I like what I know. What's the key ingredient in Sandy's good old-fashioned ketchup?
Yes. Is it tomato, Sandy?
So, ketchup, originally made with mushrooms and anchovies and oysters and nuts and other things, but not tomatoes, not tomatoes at all until the 19th century. People were rather suspicious of tomatoes because they thought they were poisonous, so people didn't eat them. But there were a lot of tomatoes around. And making tomatoes... I love tomatoes.
But, like, tomatoes from about 30 years ago and they tasted of tomato.
Where they hadn't been forced to.
Oh, you know, God, this is like an old people's...
Yeah! You remember the old tomatoes back in the day?
Everything tasted better.
It tasted like raspberries, funnily enough. Yeah.
But making actual tomato ketchup takes forever, and so when Heinz launched their own version, which was in 1876, it was marketed as a time saver. Blessed relief for mother and the other women in the household. They no longer had to make ketchup. No. And what they did, they put in a sort of thickening agent. It's called xanthan gum. And it makes ketchup into that gloopy stuff, what we call non-Newtonian liquid. So it's sort of thick in the bottle and then it becomes briefly liquid when you pour it out. Anybody know where you should hit on the bottle when you...
On the neck. Yeah. On the underside of the neck.
There's a 57 on the bottle where you're supposed to, in theory, you're supposed to hit it.
Is that where you meant to hit it?
Shake the ketchup bottle, none will come and then a lottle.
With all these healthy eating fads going on, it can feel like you're constantly playing catch-up. We're losing them, people. Well, start the car. Are you ready for the scores?
Oh, yes.
Can't wait.
So, in fourth place, I mean a long way down, with minus 13, it's Susan! Yay! In third place with minus 5, Tom! Yay.
Thank you.
In second place with 5 points, Alan. And that means the winner with a full 6 points, it's Zoe. So it's thanks to Tom, Susan, Zoe and Alan. And I leave you with a fact by American clown Red Skelton that's roughly true. Did you know that when Van Gogh cut off his ear, he actually went blind? Because every time he put his hat on, it slipped down over his eyes. Thank you and good night. Yeah.